हेलो।
हेलो सर।
हाँ, स्टार्ट करा
हेलो।
ना? यस,
हो ठीक है। हाँ
स्टार्ट करा ना।
A very good afternoon to all. Myself, R.B. Narvade, Assistant Professor, KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Nashik, welcomes you for today's national webinar on Introduction to Genome Editing and its Application to Plant Virus Control, organized by KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Nashik, affiliated to Mahatma Phule Krishi Vidyapeeth, Rahuri. I heartily welcome to the resource person for today's webinar, Dr. Basavraj Bagewadi, Assistant Professor, University of Agricultural Sciences, Dharwad. I also welcome Professor N.S. Pachpur, Principal, KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Nashik. I also welcome to all the participants for joining today's webinar session. I kindly request Professor N.S. Pachpur, Principal, KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology to introduce the KKWAP Education Society and KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Nashik.
थैंक यू मैडम। ऑन बिहाफ केके ऑफ एजुकेशन सोसाइटी एंड केके ऑफ कॉलेज ऑफ एग्रीकल्चरल बायोटेक्नोलॉजी, आई एम हेयर गोइंग टू गिव द ब्रीफ इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट द केके ऑफ एजुकेशन सोसाइटी and the KKWAP College of Agricultural Biotechnology. So the KKWAP Education Society established in the year 1970 and by the well-known social worker, that is Padma Shri late Karmanuri Kaka Sahib Wag. And now the society is celebrating 50 years of Golden Jubilee in 2020. And our inspiration, that is Honorable Sri Baya Sahib Wag, President of KKWAP Education Society, and the late Sri Kakuset Udeshi is the well-known the donor which donate the land for this our well-established KKWAG Institute of Engineering. Then next, this KKWAG Education Society is established in 1970 with the in the small village, that is the village in the Nepal. And from that beginning, now is this KKWAG Education Society is developed, or they can be spread into a various colleges. So why this KKWAG Education Society is chosen for the pursuit of excellence? So this KKWAG Education Society running this engineering college, MBA, MCA, polytechnic, pharmacy, and six agri and agri-allied colleges, senior colleges, fine arts, performing arts, and nursing, paired and junior colleges, and also these some CBSE and standard board schools. So this KKWAG is near about, they are having 20,000 plus students and 2,000 plus staff, and there are in various institutes there are near about 150 companies from the different different areas. They are recruiting our students for the placement, and there is 100% placement opportunity under this KKWAG Education Society, and still 15,000 plus alumni we are produced from this different institute of KKWAG Education Society. And also this KKWAG Society having the GRA and TOEFL center for this to study the student abroad. And also there are different types of these facilities they are developed at the different institutes. Next. Then this is about the overall number of institutes under the KKWAG Education Society at a glance. So near about 36 institutes, they are run by the KKWAG Education Society. And under this, the total student study near about 20,500. and faculty and staff to give this knowledge to this different institutes student, that is 1827, and near about 2000 faculties they are present for this education. Next, then these are the different milestones under this KKVAK Asian Society. So as the 1970, this KKVAK Vidya Bhavan Engineering College, they are started at Bhausaheb Nagar, and from this 1970 there are different types of the milestone they are established by this KKVAK Asian Society. In 1983 KKVAK Polytechnic, in 1984 branded college, that is KKVAK Institute of Engineering and Research Nasik. Then in 1993 that is the Gitai Vak Kanavindale Bhausaheb Nagar. In 1996 KKVAK Women's Polytechnic. In 2001 KKVAK English School. Then in 2003 KKVAK Art, Commerce and Science Computer Science College. And from this 2003 we are entered into the agriculture education with the starting of, that is KKVAK College of Agriculture Engineering and Technology. And then in 2007 that is the KKVAK Fine Arts. Then in 2008 KKVAK College of Education, and we also start the KKVAK Agricultural Biotechnology in 2008, and then KKVAK College of Performing Arts, KKVAK Universal School, and in 2018 recently we start the KKVAK Institute of Pharmacy. So in all the areas of education, this KKVAK Education Society, they are providing the education to the society, and these are the important milestones in the our development of KKVAK Education Society. Next. So there are different types of the technologies they are used by the faculty for teaching learning process. So it will be different types of the MOOCs, that is the online courses, then e-resources, then online assessment, assignments, then YouTube channels. The staff and faculty, they are developing or creating different videos for the teaching learning process. Then get practice software, then smartphone. Then different types of the blogs, they are produced by the different faculties for to discuss with these particular their respective courses. Then Akash tablets and the language laboratory and my exam, that is online examination software. These are the different technologies used by this KKVAK Education Society in different institutes. Next. Then these are the different recruiters. So recruiters, they are not from the Nasik, they are from the different regions of Maharashtra and different regions of India. They are come to our campus and they are take the campus drive, and the students, they are placed in various companies, that is multinational companies. After their completion of degree program, they are joining these different companies which are the two placement drives which are conducted by our KKVAK Asian Society as our one of the important activities during our course curriculum. Next. Then there are different types of the alumni meets that are conducted by the KKVAK Asian Society. This at also Washington DC, USA. There are different students, they are placed and they are at the abroad. So we take the alumni meets at the abroad also at St. John's, USA in 21st May 2016. Then at Pune on 4th February 2017 for all the institutes, the students which are passed on the different institutes, you take the alumni meet at different regions. At Houston, Texas, also we take the alumni meet. And in on the occasion of 15 years completion of our KKVAK Education Society, at the engineering college, we are also taking the, that is grand alumni meet of all the institute on 21st December 2019. Next. Then these are the different our polytechnic institute. There are four institute, that is KKVAK Polytechnic, KKVAK Women's Polytechnic, then KKVAK Polytechnic Sandori. These are the three polytechnics, and KKVAK Institute of Pharmacy, they are started in 2018, and there are 16 courses, and there are intake near about 100 and 350 intake of these polytechnics and our that is pharmacy institute. Next. then other institute, that is KKOF College of Nursing, then KKOF College of Education, that is B.Ed., then KKOF College of Fine Arts and KKOF College of Performing Arts, and KKOF College of Pharmacy, that is V-Pharm, that is 4-year degree program and their intake capacity. Next. Then KKOF College of Art, Commerce, Science, Science and Computer Science College, they are located in the Nasik at Chandori in the Diffard Taluka, then Kaka Saheb Nagar and Pimpas. Means the you are providing the education in the areas, village areas, particularly for the students which are from the village background. Next. Then this is about the KKOF College of Agriculture and Agriculture R&D Colleges. So these are the only unique institute under this KKOF Education Society. At Underby, there are 6 branches of agriculture. They are run by this society. So KKOF College of Agriculture Engineering, that is BTEC Agriculture Engineering, the intake capacity is 80, and this started in the 2003. Then KKOF College of Agriculture, BSc Agri, the intake capacity is 120, started in the 2005. Then KKOF College of Agriculture Biotechnology, that is BSc Biotech, and now degree changes to BTEC Biotechnology, intake capacity 80. Started in 2018. Then KKOF College of Food Technology, that is BTEC Food Tech, intake capacity is 80, started in 2009. Then KKOF College of Agricultural Business Management, that is BBA Agriculture Business Management, 40, started in 2011. And KKOF College of Horticulture, that is BSc Horti, that is 2200 and started in 2013. So near about 440 intake of these KKOF Agriculture and Agriculture Colleges. Then our initiative, that is Guru Shishya Punititi competition. So we take this Guru Shishya Punititi competition for the students which are in the primary and secondary things, means to develop the different types of the characteristics in there at the age of their primary and secondary. Then KKOF Kala Academy. So these are the particularly new our initiatives for to develop that is the different actors and actress to these different types of these technique. Then Karmavir Smriti Shikshak competition, particularly they are in the rural areas for to promote the sports activities. Then public lecture series for the society. Then Karmayogi and Krushi Tapasvi Puraskar, they are given by this our education society every year. Karmayogi for this social work and Krushi Tapasvi for any outstanding work under this agriculture. Then convocation at society level. Then CEO meet and HR connect for to develop a collaboration between industry and the institution. And also we can organize the science project competition for the student of 10 in order to develop the that is scientific approach under the student. Next. So this is about our KKOF Education Society at a glance. In 2008, this KKOF Agriculture Biotechnology College started. And this KKOF Agriculture Biotechnology College, they are affiliated to Mahatma Phule Vishwavidyapeeth Rahuri. And under this KKOF College of Agriculture Biotechnology, we are having an intake that is 80 intake, and we are having the different types of the departments and facilities at this KKOF College of Agriculture Biotechnology. So currently in the our college, there are 4 departments they are running. That is plant biotechnology, that is biochemistry and molecular biology, then that is the post-harvest and food biotechnology and animal biotechnology. Next. Next. So these are the different that is the visited to our institute. So these are the our results of from the 2011 and 12 to 2018 and 20. So 100% seats they are filled since 2011, and the higher cutoff than any other private colleges under this KKOF College of Agriculture Biotechnology. Then this is the some focus on our student achievements. So in the academic excellence, that is Archana Naule, they have received the Best Agriculture Student Award. Then in the research competition, our student, they are doing the research. This research hour is one of the important base under the KKOF College of Agriculture Biotechnology. So Saurabh Gurupade got the position in the research in the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. And under the sports, that is the Mr. Ganesh Narsari. They have received the silver medal and in All India Inter University grappling tournament held at MD University of Rohtak. Then the different our students are also attending the conference and seminar, also present the papers there. So Ashutosh Shetty, they are got the first prize in poster presentation organized by our university, that is Mahatma Phule Krishi Vidyapeeth Rauri. Next. Then that is the our well qualified and experienced educated faculties. So near about we have a teacher, 15 teaching faculty and 34 non-teaching faculties. So many of them, the faculties, they are qualified for the NET examination, and they are also published the different articles, that is the research articles and popular articles, and also they are for the development, they are attending the different types of the conference and seminar which are organized by these our biotechnology or as their respective courses. And also the our members having the membership of professional societies of their respective subject. So we have a well qualified and experienced dedicated faculties under the KKO College of Agriculture Biotechnology. Next. Then this is our the interaction of the faculty with the, that is the outside. So we also invite the faculties from the outside to guide the students. So under this, that is the expert lecture given by the Gaurav Malpani on the topic of what after the graduation is, what are the different opportunities for the students after their graduation. Then industrial visit, we explore the exposure given to the student to different institutes and different industries. The institute include, that is VSI, that is NRCS, SCR, IR, New Delhi. So there are different types of the educational visit organized by the college. Then we also having a hands-on training of the student from last 3 years. We are providing the research facility to 311 students. So these students, they are working under these different institute also, and they are also doing their hands-on training project under our college. Next. Then these are the success rate of our alumni in different fields. So after the pass out, there are total 338 students, they are still pass out. So near about 21 students, they are working in the farmer. Then in the related to their farmings, there are 8%. Then postgraduates, they choose the higher study, that is MSc or in MSc in agriculture biotechnology or MSc in bioinformatics, that is near about 46%. Then some of the students, they choose the banking sector and the government sector and agriculture and education sector. This agriculture and education sector, they are near about 35 students, they are choose this sector. Next. Then these are the our distinguished alumni. So Sagar Yadav is the our first batch students. They are pursuing the PhD at biological science, in the biological science in the CSIR National Chemical Laboratory, NCL Pune. Then Vishal Zagade, they are success in the civil examination in PSI in Nasik. And then Harshal Sonone, the agriculture officer in the SBI, that is State Bank of India. Then Harshita Gilante, they are working in agriculture department in Maharashtra. Then the one of the our important achievements of this alumni, that is the Rohan Shirunkar. So they are doing the PhD in biological sciences in Northern Illinois University, higher study in the abroad. And the Trishal Appagar, they are working in the Reddy's Laboratories Technical Training and Technical Property Management at Bachupalli, Hyderabad. So these are the some examples, but our other students, they are also doing the different, they are doing the work in different areas, in the agriculture, in the social, in the banking, and in the research and development areas. Okay, so this is about our small presentation about the KKOAC Education Society at a glance, and the KKOAC Agriculture Biotechnology, and the services and the different things we are provided at KKOAC Education Society. Thank you. Over to Professor R.P. Narvade, Madam.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Mrunalini Garud, Assistant Professor, KKOAC College of Agricultural Biotechnology, to introduce today's speaker.
Good afternoon to all. It's a great pleasure for me to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Baswaraj Bagewadi sir, who is recently working as assistant professor at University of Agriculture Sciences, Dharwad. Sir was research associate at Washington State University up to 2017, where he specially worked on next generation sequencing. He was worked as research scientist and postdoctoral research associate at Danforth Plant Science Center, USA. He was also a postdoctoral fellow on 2006 at Biochemistry Department, Ohio State University, Columbus, USA. Sir has completed PhD in plant molecular biology from International Center for Genetic Engineering and Biotechnology, New Delhi in 2005. He has completed MSc in plant breeding from CCS Haryana Agri University, Hisar, with a gold medal and also with ICR Junior Research Fellowship. He achieved 5 gold medals in BSc Agri from UAS Dharwad for securing the first rank and highest CGPA. Sir has 11 years of post PhD research experience in USA. He also mentored more graduates and postgraduate students. Sir has published more than 12 peer-reviewed research papers and notes in international and national journals, and also contributed a chapter for Encyclopedia of Agriculture and Food System published by Academic Press elsewhere, London, United Kingdom. Sir has worked in 2 multi-institute country research projects funded by USAID Monsanto. He has developed and validated universal plant virus DNA microarray to screen allied germplasm for all the known plant virus species. He has also contributed to the development of virus-resistant cassava for Africa using PTGS and RNAi technology for African cassava mosaic virus and cassava brown streak virus. It's our great pleasure that such a great personality is going to share his knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you, madam. Before starting the session, there is an announcement for all the participants. If you have any question, then type the question in the chat box during the session. Now I request our today's speaker, Dr. Baswaraj Bagewadi, to start the session.
Yeah. Thank you, madam. Thank you for a nice introduction, and it's my great pleasure to discuss about gene editing and its application to plant virus control. And let me start my presentation. So, can you see my presentation screen? Show screen. Okay. So can you see my presentation?
No, sir.
Okay. Okay, control panel. So show, stop showing application queue here. Screen. Okay. My screen. Now?
Yes, sir. Can, we can see.
Okay. So I'll make it into presentation mode. So good afternoon to all. So today I'm going to introduce you all. You may be already knowing it, but I will introduce a new technique of genetic engineering, that is genome editing, and its application to plant virus control. I will discuss mainly the principles and some guidelines or rules, how to utilize this genome editing technique to the plant virus control. So to begin with, so what is genome editing? Genome editing is nothing but in day-to-day life, we use our Microsoft Word. We do a lot of editing in the typings, letters, like we do delete, add, insert, we underline, italics. So same thing, we also do, similarly, we can also do genome editing in the living organisms. So where, what is our genome? Genome is nothing but chromosomes in our nucleus, in our cells. So genome editing simply refers to substituting or introducing or replacing one or more nucleotides in the our DNA. So first of all, why we need this genome editing? Genome editing, you can remember, like we all know that we use agrobacterium bacteria to for genetic engineering of the plants. For example, this insect resistant BT cotton, which is grown more than 90% of our area in the India, is developed by agrobacterium mediated transformation. That is using the agrobacterium, or sometimes we use gene gun. What are the problems with gene gun? When we have the agrobacterium, which is a natural engineer soil bacteria, so why we need this genome editing tool? The problem with agrobacterium and gene gun and other methods is these are not precise. So whenever we want to introduce the cry gene, it will go to the any of the chromosome, and also within a chromosome it will go and insert randomly. So depending on where it is inserted, the effect will be different. So for example, if we develop 100 cotton lines with cry gene, but same gene but at inserted at different places. So if the gene is inserted near the centromere, if the gene is introduced, foreign gene, that is transgene, introduced near the centromere or the telomere, the transgene will not be expressed. And we did not have any control, so where to insert the foreign gene. So there comes, in that context comes the precise or site-specific genome editing tools. So precise means where we want exactly, in the short arm, long arm, or any region of the genome, can we make the changes. The changes include deletion of one or two nucleotides, addition, or complete substitution. So what happened during 1995, one technique came, that is called ZFN. The ZFN technology is a protein-based genome editing tool. ZFN is protein-based, means what we do is, you choose a target gene and you want to make some changes in that gene. So in that case, what we do is, so I'll explain in the next slide. So the first one technique is zinc finger nuclease. Similarly, around 2002 and 2010, another tool is TALENs. TALENs stands for transcription activator like effector nucleases. So ZFN and TALENs are basically proteins, and they are also nucleases. Nucleases are the enzymes which cut DNA or RNA. So these two are the first generation and second generation genome editing tools based on protein. So during 2012, a new technique was discovered. New tool was discovered from the bacteria. The tool was taken from the bacteria. So that bacterial tool uses only two things. One, it uses one Cas9 endonuclease, and another one is RNA. So the third tool is based on RNA. So that we will see in detail in the next slides. Okay, so now first technique, zinc finger nucleases. What we do is, zinc finger nuclease is a protein, and that protein recognizes, one unit of protein recognizes three nucleotides. So here in the slide you can see, it's written like ZN, 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 ZN. So each unit of zinc finger nuclease recognizes three nucleotides, and we need two modules, one on the top strand, another one the bottom strand. So remember, here in this zinc finger nucleus, we have two parts. One is DNA binding part, another one is DNA cleaving part. That is called nucleus, and this is DNA binding part. So you all remember that restriction enzymes which are there in the bacteria to fight against the foreign DNA or transposons or viruses. They also have two parts. For example, EcoR1 enzyme has two parts. One is nuclease part, and another one is DNA binding part. So this ZFN is also like a EcoR1 enzyme. The difference is that, so EcoR1 enzyme has six recognition nucleotides, GAA, TTC. So it recognizes only the six nucleotides. Wherever that six nucleotide is found in the genome, it will go and cut. That EcoR1 enzyme we cannot use for our genetic engineering, because in a genome we will find thousands of those sites. It will cut genome into thousands of pieces. So we want nucleases which cuts in the genome only where we want or at one place. How can we do that? So to make the nucleases to be specific, what we have to do is, you know, that we have to increase the recognition site. For example, instead of six nucleotides, we have to go for at least 17 nucleotides or more than 17 nucleotides, which are unique. The probability of finding 18 nucleotides or more in a given genome is only once. That you can calculate 4 to the power 18. 4 to the power 18, that is equal to around 10 billion base pairs. So in 10 billion base pairs, we find unique 18 nucleotides. For ZFN to recognize 18 nucleotides, so this is the DNA binding part, we need 6 units. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So if we take the 6 units, it will bind to the 18 nucleotides. So remember, one unit binds to three nucleotides. So there are a possibility of three nucleotides is the possibility of getting triplet codons. Any three nucleotides, the permutation combination is 4 to the power 3. 4 to the power 3 is 64. To recognize all the triplets, we need 64 units of zinc finger binding protein. So we have already. So in the companies or in the universities, we get 64 zinc finger units. Depending on our three nucleotide sequence, you choose 6 units and you join them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You join them. So then you recognize any specific nucleotide. To which, after the nuclease binds to a specific nucleotide DNA fragment, then we add a fork 1. The cleavage part, this is fork 1, is a restriction enzyme. This is a restriction enzyme. The restriction enzyme has two parts, cleavage and binding. So we take it only the cleavage part from the fork 1. So it is called engineered nuclease. This is not a natural nuclease. Zinc finger nuclease is a artificial nuclease or synthesized nuclease. So this, if we take only one unit which binds to the one of the strand, is not sufficient. So what we do is, we need another one which binds to the bottom strand, because this fork 1 enzyme makes a dimer. Fork 1 from bottom strand and top strand makes a dimer. Even EcoR1, if you remember, EcoR1 is also having a dimer structure. So we, using this dimer structure, it makes a double-stranded cut. Our aim is to make a double-stranded cut. So then I will explain why we need a double-stranded cut. Okay, so if you understood this point, same thing is another technique which came in around 2002 and 3. There we have artificial nuclease based on TALENs, transcription activator-like elements. So these are also present in the bacteria. Xanthomonas oryzae and other bacteria. So these TALENs are there. Here you can see in the slide, there are different colors. And here the property of TALEN is, for one nucleotide, one TALEN unit binds. So we have only 4 nucleotides, ATGC. So we need only 4 TALEN units. So if you see here, there are only 4 colors. So using the 4 TALEN units, what we do is we arrange them one by one side up to 18 units of talents are attached to recognize a specific DNA fragment. So to this also we add FOC1, the nuclease part, cleavage domain, cleavage part of the FOC1 restriction enzyme is joined. So this is also artificial nuclease. So here also we have two units, top unit, bottom unit. So remember here, this each unit of TALEN and each unit of zinc finger, so they are approximately 34 amino acids. So these are both are based on protein. So now you can realize that to recognize 18 nucleotides, so remember, to recognize 18 nucleotides, we need 6 units of zinc finger protein. To recognize 18 nucleotides of DNA, we need 18 units of TALEN. So this is the if you want to target one site, we have to do engineer these proteins. So it takes a lot of time, and between zinc finger and TALEN is a longer. TALEN is a longer because we need 18 units here. So if you want to target one gene, for example, you take cry gene or any gene, if you want to make edit it, so you have to design this top unit, bottom unit. So for every gene or every site, you have to keep on designing and synthesize artificially. So it takes a lot of time and money. And there is one more problem with this is, sometimes these units are not specific. Some we want to target to one region, but they go and bind to another region. So you can say it is non-specific. This is non-specific binding is there in case of zinc finger and talents. So next. So this is the story, and there are not many studies. Zinc finger, there are few studies, and talents also not many studies are there. And people were looking something which is very easy, very simple and very easy. So third system is here. Okay. So third system is in the same slide. You can see here we have a DNA strand here, the red lines, and there is one this is a globe shaped is a protein, and here we have green shaped nucleotide is a RNA. Target DNA, we have a guide RNA, single guide RNA, and one nuclease, simple. So this is a the specificity, so where to edit is determined by the RNA. Where to edit is determined by RNA in case of CRISPR-Cas system that we will see in detail. And whereas in these two, it is protein based. Okay, so now if you understood the story, we will discuss about CRISPR-Cas based genome editing. So what is CRISPR-Cas? So if we go by the word, CRISPR is nothing but it is a stretch of DNA. CRISPR is a DNA which is having repeat and spacers. One repeat is there, spacer is there. Repeat spacer, it is a array, arrangement of those repeat and spacers. Cas9 is a nuclease. Cas9 nuclease is present in the bacteria and archibacteria. Now, why this system is there in the bacteria? So you know restriction enzymes. Restriction enzymes are the they are present to protect. They are present in the bacteria to protect against the foreign viruses. Viruses of bacteria, bacteriophages, or transposons, or some foreign DNA elements. So this system is a prokaryotic immune system. Whenever the viruses come and attack the bacteria or archibacteria, so this CRISPR system will go and cut those viruses. Okay, so CRISPR stands for clustered, means the group, regularly interspaced short palindrome repeats. So it is nothing but repeats and which are having palindromic sequences. Palindromic sequences means, like, we know that GAA, TAA, TTC, like EcoR1, we have a rotational symmetry, that is palindromic sequence. And Cas9, the full form of Cas9, you may be knowing, is CRISPR associated, because this nuclease, the this is a protein, our enzyme is associated with the CRISPR DNA sequence. Now, how it was discovered? Okay, so as I told you, this CRISPR-Cas based genetic engineering came in the year 2012, but it was there, it is there in evolutionarily, it is there millions of years ago, but only during 1993, some people observed. They were not knowing about this completely about this system. So you can see here in the bottom, so this is the CRISPR. In the bottom, you can see slide CRISPR. That is a spacer 1, spacer 2, 3, 4, 5, like this, and repeats. This is a palindromic repeat, and this is a short repeat. It is not like a very long repeat. Short repeat, like around 30 base pairs or so. So now the question comes, what is this spacer? The spacer is whenever bacteria is infected, whenever the bacteria is infected by the viruses, what does after infection, after the infection with virus, bacteria recovers, but it takes a small piece of the virus or transposon or foreign DNA. This is spacer one, is the virus sequence, and it is integrates, cuts from the virus and inserts into the bacterial chromosome. Bacteria has only one circular chromosome. It inserts there. So whatever happens, this is S1 is a virus sequence. If the virus comes and attacks again, then that bacteria will be immune. Bacteria will not be having problem with the secondary infection. Bacteria will get protection. Similarly, if another virus comes, S2 virus, then again what happens? If S2 virus comes, the bacteria will not be immune. It will get infected, and again it takes the sequence from S2 virus and inserts into this. So it keeps on virus 1, virus 2, virus 3, like this. It keeps in its memory, in the memory of its DNA, and future attacks it will be taken care. So this is the adaptive immunity. Immunity means like the ability to fight against the diseases. We have two kinds of immunity, you know, innate immunity, that is non-specific. It is common to all the pathogens, whereas we have specific immunity. Specific immunity is adaptive immunity. Whenever we get infected, then we get immunity. So CRISPR-Cas is a adaptive immunity system against the foreign viruses. So later on, similarly, during 2007 or so, they found out that this CRISPR-Cas system is a adaptive immunity system, and more than 50% bacteria have this CRISPR system, and archibacteria, they have more than 90% of the archibacteria have this system. Okay, so now this system is there. It is there in the bacteria. So what? How to utilize it now? So this system is there. So people thought, what they did is they did a next generation sequencing. So what you do is you take the bacteria, E. coli bacteria, and or any bacteria, like for example, Streptococcus pyogenes. You take the bacteria and you isolate the RNA, total RNA from the bacteria. So when you sequence those RNA, so you convert into cDNA and then sequence using the next-gen sequencing. So like Illumina, Ion Torrent, BackBack, second generation, third generation, you do, I think you have studied pyro sequencing. When you sequenced, what they Emmanuel Carpentier and Ogle, they found, normally we find tRNA and ribosomal RNA, transfer RNA and ribosomal RNA. But in addition to that, they found some RNA called RNA which is near to the CRISPR locus. For example, here in the CRISPR locus we have S1 S2. So near the next to the CRISPR locus, they found one kind of RNA coming from that region. So they called that RNA is transacting CRISPR RNA. Transacting means it comes from one region and goes to and works on another region. Transacting CRISPR RNA. So how this was possible? Because of the new technology, next generation sequencing, which was discovered during 2005 year, the year 2005. And later on that was used, and they found that what is this function of this RNA and all. So they came to know that there is a transacting CRISPR RNA. Okay, so here you see another scientist, Jennifer Doudna. She works at University of California, Berkeley campus. She is well-known structural biologist. She studies the structure of RNA, structure of DNA, RNA, and all. She showed that, so now here you can see the bottom part. There is one, this is a tracer RNA. Tracer means transacting CRISPR RNA, and this is CRISPR RNA. How does this CRISPR RNA comes? CRISPR RNA comes from CRISPR DNA, correct? From CRISPR DNA, during transcription, we get RNA, CRISPR RNA, correct? And this CRISPR RNA doesn't make any protein. So there is only transcription, no translation. So CRISPR RNA comes from that spacer, repeat comes. So transacting CRISPR RNA comes from the nearby region. So Jennifer Doudna showed that these two RNAs are required for the CRISPR-Cas genome editing. What she did is she made the very simple one engineering, genetic engineering. Genetic engineering is nothing but joining, cutting, all that is engineering. We have civil engineering, mechanical engineering. Here we have a genetic engineering. What she did is she joined tracer RNA and CRISPR RNA. And it is called single guide RNA. To make the things very simple, she joined this, means using the structural knowledge, she joined it and made into only one RNA. So now this simple is very simple for all our study. So you remember this thing, for all our genome editing study, we need only single guide RNA. Okay, so this CRISPR immunity, which is present in bacteria. So I already told you, bacteria acquires and insert into the foreign DNA whenever there is an infection. Second one is, this one we have discussed. Second one is CRISPR RNA biogenesis. That also I told you, in the transcription of CRISPR DNA, we get CRISPR RNA. So you remember CRISPR RNA, there are spacer 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what happens, that CRISPR 5 spacers will be processed. That precursor RNA is cut into small pieces and converted into individual RNA, each having one spacer. So that spacer RNA and transacting RNA together goes and combines with the nuclease. This, remember, CRISPR associated endonuclease. So now the function of endonuclease is to go and the function of endonuclease is to cut the RNA or DNA. If it is a DNA nuclease, it will cut DNA. If it is RNA nuclease, it will cut RNA. But where to cut? There are so many regions, correct? Where to go and cut? It cannot cut non-specifically, go and cut anywhere. So what it does is, so this CRISPR RNA is a approximately 20 nucleotides, 20 to 30, but in here we use 20 nucleotides. So you remember, to find 20 nucleotides randomly in a genome is possible only once. A unique sequence of 20 nucleotides is found only one time in a genome. So that CRISPR RNA tells where to go and bind. The binding is, it is a RNA-DNA hybridization. So that is very, very, very unique. So this CRISPR RNA and Cas protein, RNA plus protein, RNA plus that endonuclease go and search chromosome 1, 2, 3, 4. It scans, but wherever it finds the complementarity with respect to RNA, it will go and bind and makes two cuts, top strand, bottom strand. So here you know this Cas9, there are Cas 1, 2, 3, 4 different endonucleases are there. So therefore it is called Cas9 endonuclease, and it is a natural nucleus, not like zinc finger nucleus or TALEN. It is a natural protein, natural nucleus, and works along with RNA. So there are many systems, and in our mostly genome engineering, there are 6 types. There are 2 classes, class 1, class 2, and there are 6 types. So in our study, we use always class 2 and type 2 systems. Now, one more point here. So this Cas9 nuclease and RNA go and bind to the genome wherever that 20 nucleotide goes and binds. There is one more requirement that is called protospacer adjacent motif. Means next to the 20 nucleotides, there should be in the DNA 3 nucleotide regions, that is called NGG or NAG. So 20 nucleotides plus these 3 nucleotides, wherever there in the genome, it will go and identify. So in the genome engineering, in the genome editing, the important thing is to identify the target. Go and first identify the target, and this machinery, RNA plus protein, go and bind there. That is very, very important thing. So after binding, what happens? The target DNA will be cut into 2 parts. So then we will see what happens here. Okay, so here again, recap. So in this slide, we see this red color dots are a spacer, blue color ones are the protospacers. From transcription, we get precursor CRISPR RNA. From precursor RNA, then we use RNase-3 like enzyme. And in the C here panel, we get this blue color, blue and red color line is spacer RNA. And this is the green line is a tracer RNA. So these two and this Cas9 comes and makes a cut here. In the last bottom line, you can see double strand DNA target is there. So one more thing is you can see here PAM, protospacer adjacent motif. So this here in my, if you see my mouse cursor here, this 3 nucleotide is there, and on left side is our spacer. To this blue color spacer, our RNA comes. This is a DNA RNA. Whenever there is a hybridization, we see 2 scissors here. So those scissors are nothing but from Cas9 cuts DNA, and we get double stranded DNA here. So from here, okay, double stranded DNA, what happens whenever there is a double stranded cut in the body will not tolerate, human body or anybody, like any organism. So there is a DNA repair, you know, DNA replication and DNA repair. Body will, or any organism will try to repair it. There are 2 repair mechanisms. One is non-homologous end joining, means without the homologous chromosome. In bacteria, there is no homologous chromosome. Bacteria, we have only one. Bacteria is a kind of haploid. There is no another chromosome. So what it double strand break, what happens? It joins using the repair machinery. But before repair, sometimes what happens, one or two nucleotides are cut. So what happens when they join? There is a frame shift mutation due to the addition of one extra nucleotide or due to the deletion of one extra nucleotide. So what happens whenever that protein coding, if it is a protein coding DNA, then protein will be truncated because stop codon will be introduced there. So this is what is our job is just to introduce double strand break. then host machinery will take care. We do not do anything there. Automatically, the host machinery will repair the break. While repairing, it makes mistake, and that is editing. Okay, so now for this is the, so far we see how we obtain double stranded break, and if we want to utilize this to our plants, animals, fish, animals and all, so what we need is first one we need is Cas9 protein, that is endonuclease. Second one is we need a guide RNA and scaffold, protein and RNA. Okay, so RNA, this guide, single guide RNA is around 100 base pairs, around 100 base pairs. In 100, we have to the one end, we have to choose what gene we want to target. That is only 20 nucleotides. 20 nucleotide is a address, kind of a address, which goes bind wherever we tell. And remaining 80 or more, 80 nucleotides is a constant. So I am talking about single guide RNA. Single guide RNA has two parts. One part is a guide part, another one is a scaffold part. Scaffold is around 80 nucleotides, guide is 20 nucleotides. So if you want to change the your target gene, if you want to target gene number 2, if you want to target, you change only that 20 nucleotides. You don't, no need to change the scaffold or no need to change the Cas9. So it is very easy here. Changing the target is just you have to change the 20 nucleotides RNA. We can get the RNA synthesized from the companies. You give to companies, like just like primers, they synthesize RNA also. Proteins, we have to prepare in our laboratory or we can get it in the company also. This Cas9 is nothing like our EcoR1 restriction enzyme. Restriction enzymes we order from bio labs, so many companies, Fermentas, NEB and companies. We get Cas9 protein and CRISPR RNA with 20 nucleotides you specify. Okay. Now, next one is base pairing between guide RNA and target DNA causes double strand breaks due to the endonuclease activity of Cas9. And okay, next. So this is here one important thing, changing the target specificity. So if you want to change another gene, is you use only change the RNA, 20 nucleotide RNA. So we can, people are working to make this system inducible. Whenever light inducible or chemical inducible, that can also be made. Okay. So now coming to the components. So these two components we have seen, guide RNA 20 plus 80. Now comes how many guide RNAs are required. To, for example, you want to silence a bad gene, gene which is toxic, which is not required. You want to edit it. Edit means remove one nucleotide or add one nucleotide to make the protein non-functional. So we can use one guide RNA or two guide RNAs. So usually one or two is okay. Now then, before choosing the, in a, for example, you take a gene. Now you want to where to target. For example, your gene is 1000 nucleotides long. So you can target in the 50th position, 100 position, 150, 200, 800, 900, 700. So location, where we can. So wherever we see, wherever we see this NGG, we can choose that. So it is very easy. NGG, the probability of finding NGG is 4 to the power 6. That is every 16 nucleotides on an average, we can get NGG, these things. So that is, we have to first look for NGG. Then on the left side, we go for 18 to 20 nucleotides. Okay, so this is done. Cas endonuclease is, Cas9 is very commonly used. That is there. Next comes target region now. Target region. For example, in a gene, sometimes what happens, DNA, they form secondary structures. Whenever there are repeats, when if there are the too many repeats in the DNA, they make secondary structure, and our this 20 nucleotide RNA cannot go and bind there. So therefore, we have to be very careful about target region. So now I want to tell one thing about target region. So Now, so far you have seen genome editing using CRISPR-Cas. The tools are simple, but the target region now, target region or you can say target gene, you can say. So the target gene should be well characterized. If you edit that gene, it should not cause something else. For example, some genes are multifunctional. If you want to silence that gene or edit that gene, it will have a some other functions also inhibited. So therefore we should be careful. And there is another criteria also. So whenever we choose 20 nucleotide target, 20 nucleotide guide RNA, so that should be unique. It should not match to the any other site. Remember, if you want to edit only one gene, it should not have any other effect. So this is very important in case of humans. So if you want to, for example, just I'm telling, if you want to silence a gene in a liver or some region, you can say, it should not go and bind to the some other organs. Then it will be very, very dangerous. If you want to target in the blood cell, it should not go to the kidney cells. So some other gene. So that should be, that is called off target. Off target effect is non-specific effect is there. So it is very important, especially in case of plants, in animals. Okay. Now a little bit about this Cas9 protein. The reason I'm showing this protein is all proteins, you know, like they have primary structure, secondary, tertiary, and quaternary structure. So this is a, on the right side, you can see three-dimensional structure. And this Cas9, the specialty about this is it has recognition sequence, DNA recognition sequence, and PAM sequence. So this Cas9 protein recognizes the PAM in the target DNA, and it has two nucleus domain, RUVC and HNH. These are the two domains in the Cas9 protein, which makes two cuts in the DNA, double stranded DNA. And another interesting feature of this protein is it is very long. Remember, 1368 amino acids. 1316 amino acid means the gene is almost three times larger. So this is a very large protein. So we will see why it is problem sometimes. So here, this green color is a RNA. This is a Cas9 protein, binds to the DNA wherever there is a this red color, if you see line is a our address, 20 nucleotides. This red color comes and binds to the near the wherever complementarity is there, near the PAM sequence. So 1, 2, 3 here, you can see finally the DNA is broken into double strand. Okay, now here it is very interesting. Here, whatever you take, zinc finger, talon, or CRISPR, our final goal is to make a double-stranded break in specifically. After this, what happens? There are two methods of repair. So for example, this double-strand breaks happens in our body also. So you remember, this CRISPR-Cas is not present in eukaryotes. It is not present in plants. It is not present in human. We have another mechanism that I will discuss later. So we don't have CRISPR system in our body, but we have DNA repair system. We also get double strand breaks in our body every time. And our body repairs very quickly by non-homologous end joining. And there is another method, homology directed recombination. Homology directed repair or recombination. So what happens in humans, in one chromosome there is something problem, another chromosome from homologous chromosome comes and that will be repaired. This is homologous chromosome will be repaired. If we don't have, for example, if we don't have the homologous chromosome, we can give externally. If we can give the, for example, genome editing can be used to replace the gene, not just edit. We can use the genome editing based on CRISPR-Cas for gene replacement also. So there is a, what we have to do is, if you want to replace the bad gene, or then what you do is you take the correct gene, the gene which you want to express in a plasmid. So, and the surrounding of that gene should be, like you see the cross mark here, the surrounding region should be homologous, and due to the homology dependent repair, correct gene will be inserted into the this DNA. For homology directed, we can use two cuts. So here in the top, we saw only one cut. If you want to replace this middle part, big part, we can have another cut here. So another cut means another 20 nucleotides RNA. So make it two cuts, and middle portion, like 1000 base pair, 2000 base pair, will be removed, and correct one will be replaced. This is, and this, you remember, this is happening in the host, that we will see in the plant or animals or so. So this, once we make our double strand cut, our job is done. Host will take care. Okay. So now coming to the applications. Applications, there are from 2012, it was discovered, 2015-13 onwards, people have been using for agriculture, veterinary, medical field, human health, and also very importantly, the applications are for the basic science to know what is the function of a gene. For example, if we don't know, for example, in humans or in plants, we don't know the function of many genes. We have more than 30,000 genes, but all the functions we don't know. Functions of all the genes are not known. So in that case, what we do is take one gene at a time, one by one. You design 20 nucleotide guide RNA, use the scaffold, 80 nucleotide scaffold, and Cas9. So you go and silence and see what happens to the cell or to the organism. If you silence gene number one, nothing happens, means it is not important for the plant growth or development or disease or whatever. So application is in the basic science and medical field, agriculture field. We can apply this CRISPR-Cas based method in all the living organisms, wherever they have RNA or DNA genome. Okay, so it has been already, it has been successfully utilized in the commercial plants as well as model plants. Arabidopsis, tobacco, and cotton, potato, wheat. And you know, all agriculturally important crops are polyploids. Even there also, for example, wheat, bread wheat is hexaploid. So hexaploid, what happens? We have three chromosomes, six chromosomes, three pairs of chromosomes. Chromosome, like we call genome A, B, D. So using the guide RNA, which is common to all the three chromosomes, we can edit genes in all the six copies. Six copies of the gene can be edited. Only thing is that six guide RNA should be very, very conserved. So now, here, before using, for example, to the plants, we have to see whether this guide RNAs, whatever guide RNAs we are choosing, because for a single gene, we can design for single gene, we have an option of getting hundreds of guide RNAs. But which one will you choose? Correct? Which one we choose? So we choose based on the guide RNA should not be having too many repeats, like AAAGG, four, more than four G's, A's, like that we should not have. And it should not form a secondary structure. And it should be having GC content of 50 to 60%. It's like any other common thing. Okay, so now what happens in case of application to agriculture and crops? Okay, so one important thing is all the manipulations, all the genome editing we have to do in the cell level. Remember, single cell level. In case of plants, where we get single cells, you take the leaf, get the callus, and we get the callus is a undifferentiated mass of cells. We have to do all these manipulations in the single cell stage. We cannot do this genome editing in the when the plant is grown to the leaf and also and so. So we have to take the single cell, then using our transformation method, you use electroporation, you use gene gun, you use agrobacterium. So we have to put somehow we have to put inside the nucleus. Wherever DNA is there, in the nucleus. So we have to put Cas9 protein, CRISPR RNA into the nucleus. That is one option. So that is okay. Another option is to, instead of putting directly RNA and protein, we can put the vector. So if you put the vector having the gene for CRISPR RNA, gene for the Cas protein, so it will, inside it will go and make the protein and RNA, and then does its job. Okay, so now we have come to that point. So this is strategy. What is strategy for the generation of this CRISPR-Cas genome editing? First, here one option I told you is without any vector. Now I'm going to, in this slide, I'm going to tell about the vector. Using the DNA vector, we get protein and RNA. Another, here what we do is we have to have the promoter. Here it is promoter, 35S promoter, Cas9 gene, and terminator. So after translation, it makes Cas9 protein. And another we have is promoter, and this red color one is the only 20 nucleotides. This gray color is the 80 nucleotide RNA. It doesn't make protein because it doesn't have any sequences for making protein. Only transcription happens here. So from these two, we put vector. You know how to put vector into the plant cells. That is by agrobacterium method or by the gene gun method. So what happens, before putting them into the single cell? For example, single cell, it is a very tedious process. You may be knowing tissue culture takes a lot of time and a lot of time as well as money. So what we do is before transforming the plant cells, we can put, that is called transient expression. Transient means temporary expression. So there we infiltrate the plant leaves. And for example, in this case, the gene is chlorophyll example. For you, suppose the gene makes, it goes and cuts the chlorophyll gene. If the chlorophyll gene is cut, so the leaf will become yellow. So what happens, using a syringe without needle, we put this vector in an agrobacterium into the leaf. And what happens, if that genome editing is happening, our target was the chlorophyll gene, so we see the yellow color. So we see the yellow color leaf. Then we isolate the DNA from the leaf and then check. We check whether there is an insertion or deletion of the DNA sequence. Then that is by sequencing we come to know genome editing has happened or not. So you remember, this all happens through single cell method. So here in this example, I am taken from cotton. Here we are putting two guide RNAs here. So here you can see, I will just go through quickly. Promoter, Cas9 protein, terminator. Promoter here is, we are using the RNA Arabidopsis U6 promoter. And here you see, this red color is the 20 nucleotide guide RNA. Then we have three nucleotide PAM sequence, TGG, or it should be any NGG sequence is there. And here we have two guide RNAs. So to make at two places, this is multiplex expression of the guide RNAs. Okay, now some other applications is, how can we, other applications, potential applications. First one is disease and pest resistance. For example, we know that there are some genes in the plant which make them plants susceptible. If the gene is present, or then plants becomes susceptible to the disease. So one example is eukaryotic initiation factor 4E. So initiation factor 4E, that makes plants susceptible to all the viruses, that portiviruses, viruses of the Portiviridae family. So now we know that knowledge. So can we use this genome engineering, change the plant, edit the plant such that that gene is mutated, that gene doesn't make protein, so we can make the plant and this pest resistance. So for this genome engineering, we have to have the knowledge. For example, I told you, eukaryotic initiation factor 4E and G, it is known before. If that knowledge is not there, we cannot use. If that knowledge is not there, we cannot, even if we have the tool in our hand, we cannot apply, because we have to know which gene to silence. Similarly, if there are any genes which are inhibiting the germinations, like if they, and another one is nutritional quality. For example, there is a Kesari Dal, one Lateris sativus. They in Madhya Pradesh and some region, they say that too much consumption of that Kesari Dal is problematic, has some toxin gene, toxic produced. Then what we have to do is to reduce the toxic or remove the toxic, what we have to do, you design guide RNAs to that toxic gene, producing that toxic gene, and produce, modify that Kesari Dal plant. And similarly, we have a, in pharmaceutical field and in agricultural field, validation of drug targets. For example, we have to see whether our drug goes to whatever the chemical drugs, we have chemical drugs, compounds, whether it goes and binds to the particular protein. So what we do is we mutate the protein, then we come to know that this drug is really binding to that protein or not. So that is called drug validation. Similarly, we can do in case of insecticides, pesticides, and herbicides. Then in case of quantitative genetics, plant breeding genetics, we have some genes in the plant. They are, we don't know, QTL. QTL means they are quantitative trait loci. They are large regions, not genes, like 100 KB, 50 kilobase pairs, region of DNA genome, which are shown to control drought tolerance, salinity tolerance. So what we do is take genes from that region and silence and see whether we get our drought tolerances inhibited or no. And we can also create some new alleles or to have functions. So this is basically, if you don't know the function of gene, you can use it to know the functions. And this is some more examples. Okay, now I'm coming to, So far we saw plant improvement. So briefly, I will tell about virus. So I'll specifically tell about plant viruses. So plant viruses, like nowadays we are discussing all about viruses. So you see plant viruses, there are two kinds. If you categorize DNA virus, RNA virus. So in case of both viruses are causing huge economic losses in our many agricultural crops, like tomato yellow leaf curl virus, bean golden mosaic virus, wheat dwarf virus, and so and so. So here we have plant viruses. So you can see their genome is, most of the viruses have 20 kilobase pairs. Viruses are very small, 20 kilobase pairs, but they have created so much problem. Even our coronavirus is only 30 kilobase pairs. And here I was telling, plant viruses have DNA genome, RNA genome. In DNA also, they have single-stranded DNA, double-stranded DNA. In RNA also, they have single-stranded RNA, double-stranded RNA. And in single-stranded RNA, we have plus strand, plus single-stranded RNA, negative single-stranded RNA. Why I'm telling this is, our coronavirus is also plus single-stranded RNA virus. And the genome structure resembles as that of potato virus. Y, potato virus X, they belong to Potiveridae. They have single stranded RNA with plus strand sense. Coronavirus is also single stranded plus strand RNA virus. Okay, that is different. So now, okay, so quickly, there are several control strategies. Why suddenly we before CRISPR-Cas, before zinc finger, what people are doing? So we commonly use conventional control strategies, like we use insecticides. You know, most of the viral diseases are transmitted by the insects. So we simply use insecticides, and that results to the pollution of water and soil and so on and so. And also we can have some cultural practices, agricultural practices like early sowing, proper management of nutrition. Just like humans, even plants which are having healthy plants, they register the disease. And we also have other tools like resistance breeding, like traditional breeders, we use crossing, hybridization, use the one wild varieties with the cultivated variety. Then we select the disease resistant lines. But in plant, traditional plant breeding is a great tool. It has contributed so much to the green revolution, and today also it is contributing. But in traditional plant breeding, we cannot control how much gene is coming from the wild plant. When we want to transfer the good gene from a wild plant, unknowingly or knowingly, we transfer some other genes also. But here in genome editing, as we discussed so far, so much that we can, using this tool, we can go to any part of the genome and change that or insert also. So that is genome engineering. And for virus control, there is another strategy also, you know all, that is RNA interference. So RNA interference is another tool commonly used. So in the next slides, I will show you some differences. Okay, so here, remember, CRISPR is a bacterial immunity, and it targets mainly DNA and also nowadays RNA also. CRISPR can, for example, CRISPR Cas9 is a nuclease. It goes and binds to DNA and cuts the DNA. But we have other Cas, like Cas13 or so. It goes, that cuts RNA. If the, as I told you, RNA is a virus. Many RNA are viruses. So we can do RNA can also be cut. So now one important point here RNA interference was discovered, it was there around 1993 and 1998 it got Nobel Prize. So very interestingly, RNAi is a eukaryotic immune system, means humans, we have the RNAi system in our body. This RNAi system is there in the plants also, it is there, and all zebrafish and any, all the eukaryotic organisms, we have RNAi in our body, but CRISPR-Cas is not there. So it, RNAi is also called PTGS, post translational gene silencing, and here it works, it inhibits the RNA level. It is a RNA, it cuts RNA, but here it is genome, it cuts the DNA at the genome level only. And another very important tool is, I will just briefly mention, in CRISPR-Cas we can use the transgene free plant. We can develop the, for example, I was telling you kesari dal, Lathares sativus. We can develop the kesari dal without transgene. To develop, what we do is, first we take the kesari dal protoplast or single cell, use this CRISPR-Cas editing. Once editing is done, we can we get the hemizygous condition. If you understand, it's okay. So what happens in Lathares sativus, that has a two chromosomes. This, our agrobacterium goes and binds to one chromosome, on one chromosome. After segregation, when we do a crossing, this CRISPR construct, once it cuts the DNA, we don't need it. So I think that much is okay here. So there is a possibility of obtaining the transgene free plants from CRISPR-Cas technology. Therefore, there is a lot of interest. This is the main reason here why it is so popular here and everybody is talking about this. So since 2002, Indian government is not allowing any transgenic plant. Only cotton plant is allowed since 2002. Since then, there is no transgenic plant in the India. So companies like Monsanto, Bayer, Mahiko, and other companies, now they are excited. They are very much excited about to utilize this crop. I will also tell students to learn about these techniques, not only knowledge, theory, also wherever possibility during your internship to get the practical skills. Because in the coming years, all companies will be working on this technique. Already they are working. Okay, so now, so just these two differences are okay here. So this is present in eukaryote. And during that time, 2002 only, people were searching why RNAi is not there in the bacteria. So then later on, we came to know that bacteria also has similar to RNAi in bacterial system also. Now we discussed how we are utilizing the bacterial system. And many people say that why should we study bacteria when we are in agriculture? Why microbes are important and also? So there are many other mechanisms. Restriction enzyme is one mechanism. This CRISPR is another mechanism. So there are so much diversity in a small microbes. So we should study more microbes and see maybe there are some more mechanisms are there in some other bacteria. So from studying the bacteria, we are changing even human health and also agriculture and everything. It has revolutionized just like next gen sequencing. Some differences I mentioned, and quickly I'll go. And I think in 10 minutes I'll finish, 5 to 10 minutes. Okay, so coming to the Gemini viruses here, some principles I will tell you. So viruses, this is a Gemini viruses is a DNA virus and having single strand DNA. The important diseases are like African cassava mosaic virus, tomato yellow leaf curl virus, bean mosaic virus, and so and so. So here now you know you have the tools in your hand. So now so if you want to control the, okay, now I want to make very one important principle here. If you want to control the viruses, we have two options. One is go target the virus gene, which is important for its replication movement. That is target the virus gene only. Or you have another option, go and target the host gene. For example, if you want to, tomato leaf curl virus is there. So you go and edit the tomato gene. And in tomato has 25,000 to 30,000 genes. But as of now you very important thing here, there is no plant gene. We don't know which gene to target. If you target that gene, we will get a virus resistance. It is not known even today. So we have no option here. Although we have the tool, but no option here. So what we do is instead we go and target the virus gene. This virus has only 6 genes. One here in yellow color is a replication initiator protein, coat protein, and some replication enhancer, transcription activator. So it has only 6 protein, and this virus is in 2 parts, DNA A and B. That is okay, and this much enough. So only it has total of 6 genes. So it is very easy, and there is no much brain required to select which gene to target. We know that replication initiation protein is very important. So we select this gene. Half the work is done. We selected the gene. Next one is, this is, we have some important genes. This also we see. So now we have selected the gene. Now target region within that gene. So if you select the gene, you know, protein has amino acid and carboxyl end. So preferably we have to target the protein near the amino acid end, so that if you edit the gene in the end, so protein will be, half the protein will be functional, half or 3/4 protein will be functional. So target should be near the 5 prime end. How many sgRNAs? 1 or 2 near the 5 prime region. Okay, so now I think here CRISPR edited crops, using CRISPR edited we develop the crops. So product wise, for example, we edit the crop, and what happens, to develop this CRISPR edited crop, we need agrobacterium transformation tissue culture, very long lengthy process. We need the tissue culture, and this called product wise, process wise. To process is, yes, it is a transgenic plant, transgenic technology is there. But finally what we do is, once our editing is done, by crossing with other plants, we remove the this transgene means that Cas9, scaffold and hygromycin selection, we remove that product. Finally it is clean. Okay, and if we don't want any problem of DNA, sign of DNA in the plant, then we can use protein and RNA instead of vector. There is no need of vector, that option is also there. Okay, so some more points here I will mention. So this technology is so easy, we can understand within, if you read very quickly, everything is simple. And so can we do it? Can Monsanto or Myco company use it? No. So who has discovered it? Who has worked on this? So this is all done by the companies outside, California, MIT, and other companies. They have all patented these technologies. So micro company cannot use this technology, make lakhs of or millions of money. Nobody can make. We have to pay the royalty license fee. So for our research purpose, if you want to do any research, or if you want to teaching purpose, research purpose, it is free. Anybody can use even patented technology. But you have to remember, therefore, all students, all of us have to develop this technology indigenously. India has to develop this technology. Otherwise, lifelong, we have to keep giving them royalty and license fee. So this also you keep in mind. And also comes safety. So this is another issue. Whenever we work on genetic engineering and all, we have to be very careful, follow all the safety and also the rules about whatever the Department of Biotechnology gives the rules, we have to all follow. So now some people in the transgenic plant, they express Cas9 and sgRNAs separately or together. It's not so important. Okay. So now coming to the little bit technicalities. Now, here I am in Dharwad. We are working on this one of the virus, chili leaf curl virus, which is a Gemini virus. And it has a one important protein called replication initiation protein. And this protein is around 360 amino acids, 1 to 360 amino acids. So what I did in here is I selected the here, wherever in the top line is the gene, below line is the protein. So I, using my eyes, just I select, went through the sequence. I found wherever GG is there, NGG, correct? Wherever GG is there, and I selected 20 nucleotides left side of that. And one thing here in the principle of virus control is you have to select the 20 nucleotide in this gene, in this slide, which is conserved. For example, chili leaf curl virus. This is one example of virus. Chili leaf curl virus, there are strains, means same species, but within a species, there are hundreds of strains. Chili leaf curl, Dharwad, chili leaf curl, Parvani, chili leaf curl virus from Latur, like this, Kolhapur, like this, there are different strains, Bangladesh, Pakistan. So same case in case of our COVID virus, novel coronavirus, there are many strains. Depending on which Ahmedabad region, Bangalore, Delhi, like this. So when you choose the guide RNAs, you have to choose guide RNAs, which is conserved, highly conserved. What happens if there is a virus mutates? Viruses are, you know, very much they keep on changing, but we have to select from the conserved regions. In the conserved regions, virus cannot change. If they change, virus will not survive. So this is very simple. Select the conserved regions, which is common to all the 100 strains. Or sometimes what you can do is, you remember chili leaf curl virus, tomato leaf curl virus. They belong to the same Gemini virus family, Gemini viridae family, Bigomo virus. So we can design guide RNA, which is common to all the 20 viruses. So in one guide RNA, we can control 20 viruses. Same thing, if you want to select this guide RNAs for COVID virus, we can choose that 20 nucleotide guide RNA, COVID guide RNA, which is common to all the things. And for your, just for information, I'm telling. So you just imagine, take Cas9 and some guide RNA specific to COVID-19 virus, inject into the body. But the problem here is, one problem in case of human, isn't it? We have to just choose 20 nucleotides against the COVID virus and deliver wherever it is required. But the question is very difficult. How do you deliver? First of all, how do you deliver to the lung cells, alveoli cells? There is very difficult mechanism. If it is in the blood, it's okay. In the blood, you inject, the guide RNAs go and Cas9 and guide RNA go and cut the COVID virus here. But in lung, how do you deliver in human? So you, in your next 20 years, this CRISPR guide RNAs will be used as a therapeutics. But as of now, there is no knowledge at all. There is no safety knowledge. There is no trials. Nothing is there. So just conceptually, I'm telling. Another scope for all of you students is to study the drug delivery. This CRISPR is a drug. That RNA is a RNA-based drug. But delivery is a big, big problem in brain. How do you deliver to the brain cells? It's very, very difficult. Okay. So now, so we have, so here you can do manually if this is a small gene, or you can also do, you can select guide RNAs using the software also. One common software is Syntego. Syntego is commonly used for human, mouse, rat, model organisms. Using this, we can ask the software, give me 20-30 guide RNAs which are very effective. Okay, so here in this slide I'm showing, from 2013 onwards, there are already studies using this genome editing technologies. First one is zinc finger nuclease, TALENs, and CRISPR-Cas. You can see here, TALEN, there are not much studies because this technology came in 2010. Before it became popular, another technology came. So it is not much used. So this slide shows that this is a reliable technology. We can rely on it, use it for plant virus control, and in the future days, animal virus control also. But there is one more difference I will tell you. Here we are making the plant, we are taking the single cell of the plant and modifying it. And plant will express lifelong this Cas9 protein guide RNA. Whenever virus comes, it goes and bind and cuts it. But we cannot do it. You know, it's ethical issues, legal issues. In humans, we cannot make humans to express Cas9 and RNA. It is unethical. It is not, we cannot do. But plants, we have that freedom. But in animals, it is different. In animals or humans, we can only use, we can make animals as a transgenic animals, expressing this Cas protein and RNA. But in humans, it is impossible. Only we can use, only in the embryo stage, we can, single cell of human is embryo. We can manipulate in embryo only, but that is illegal. And some Chinese scientists have done it, but that is not illegal. So this is briefly about studies in viruses. Okay. So one point here I want to say is, in case of, I told you one thing, in case of DNA viruses, in 5 more minutes, there is no plant gene known so far. But in case of RNA virus, we know, for RNA viruses, one gene is known. By editing that, we can get resistance. That is EIF4A4G. So therefore, work should be done to discover such target in the DNA for DNA viruses. Okay, so this is also, I'll skip quickly. So here, this is also one of the another example. Take any target, any one of the gene, and before you make a full transgenic plant, you can in the laboratory we can check whether that RNA works or not, guide RNA. So this is molecular analysis. Molecular analysis of the, whenever you do the CRISPR, using CRISPR-Cas based genome editing, we check whether plant virus is making any RNA or not by using the, check the virus DNA by PCR, RNA by the northern blotting, and also by southern blotting DNA. So this, I will skip it. So this is, I'm working, chili leaf curl virus. So you know all the importance. And I want to say one thing here is, few more slides. Here, in case of plants, what we do is, we use, this is a agrobacterium construct. Agrobacterium construct, it has one selection marker to select the plants, because that is hygromycin. And all the genes are present between left border and right border. Hygromycin is a selection marker. Then we have a, this is single guide RNA, Cas9. And we also have a selection marker for bacteria. So this is a vector-based transformation system we are doing. So here I want to highlight you is, this is some of the work we have started work. So for tissue culture is started in 1993, even before that, Maheshwari and Guha, we see anther culture and all, we study in our classrooms and all. So plant transformation came using agrobacterium in 1983. So people say this is a very old technology, tedious, there is no scope and all, because India is not allowing transgenic crops. But for to be successful in case of plants, or even in case of animals also, animal tissue culture, So we have to have very strong tissue culture and all the basic sciences. So these new technologies don't replace the old technologies. So these new technologies always work along with the old technologies. So we should not think only these are important, old technologies are not unimportant. So very quickly, I'll show you some run. So a lot of work is required for tissue culture because we have to do manipulation in the single cell. And from that single cell, we have to generate complete plant. And you know all, so far tissue culture is not successful in all the crops and within a crop also. For example, cotton, only one variety or two variety are we can do regeneration. Remaining thousands of varieties in cotton or any other crop, tissue culture protocol is not established. So for students, you are BSc students, MSc students, you have a lot of scope to work on these problems. So I will discuss that very little. So this is some study. Okay, now, so using CRISPR-Cas, some transgene free plants have been released in the United States. Some examples I'm giving. For example, like in Europe, people don't like transgenic crops. In USA, it is okay. So what they have done is these are, so far slides I quickly showed you, they are the lab studies they have done in the laboratory using sometimes tobacco, Arabidopsis, and sometimes crop plants. And all those studies are very small scale, just to show it works. But there is a lot of scope to convert them into field level. So many I showed you around, there are 10 to 12 studies to get virus resistance. But in the field, we don't see. It takes a lot of time. Here I will quickly show you, like commercially, mushroom, all of we eat mushroom, their mushroom becomes brown. So what they have done is they have silenced the polyphenol oxidase. If you reduce that gene, the browning will be less. Then we have similarly other genes like camelina. Here we can change the oil composition. In case of soybean, we have a drought tolerance and like this. So here the major advantage you remember is possibility of obtaining transgene free improved crops, which is not possible in agrobacteria and other methods and wherever we want. So this is mushroom, genome edited mushroom. First organism to get the license means they see the regulatory agency said it's safe, there is no transgene in the plant. Okay, you can use it. This is camelina plant. Okay, this is last two slides, final last slide. So what are the challenges now? Correct. So we see, is it everything good? Is it so simple? And can anybody work? One problem I told is intellectual property proper things. Second one is tissue culture. Tissue culture is very, very tedious and not possible in all crops. Okay, now for agriculture is concerned, one is in agricultural crops, the traits are not governed by one gene. You silence one gene, we get drought tolerance. No, because in plants, commercial crops, genes are controlled by 20 genes. The traits are controlled by 20 genes. They are called polygenic quantitative gene. And transformation is tedious and target in many crops we don't know the complete genome sequence. There also we have a problem. So with this this I will not explain, it is too detailed. So Cas9 is used for DNA editing, whereas we have some other Cas variants, Cas9 alternatives naturally occurring from other bacteria. Cas9 is from Streptococcus pyogenes. But I want to show from this slide is there are lots of other options, Cas9 proteins. So this is artificially engineered. Wherever there is a problem, we can use this thing. As I told you, Cas9 is a very big gene, 4,000 base pairs. So people have developed Cas9, which is smaller, 3,000 base pairs. Why it is a problem? I showed you one vector there, correct? Hygromycin and all those. If the gene is big, it is difficult to do cloning there. Transformation and cloning is difficult. So we have Cas9 alternatives, which are smaller. And I made some more slide. Last one slide is how students can utilize it, correct? You being a student, MSc or BSc students. So it will help you to get admission into your newer university abroad. And top institutes like ICER, Pune, ISER Tirupati, ISER Kolkata, like that. So many good labs are working on this CRISPR technologies. If you know and have worked on this, you have a better choice of chance of getting into that. And similarly, if you want to get employment in the companies, there also you have a higher chance. And for self-employment also, people who are well off in a family-wise and they want to start a company entrepreneurship and take some little bit risk, calculated risk, and they can work on the problems. What are the problems? Like tissue culture, simply. It's not established for all that. And another option for startup ideas for your startup things is take this license from this genome-edited mushroom, genome-edited lethary sativas, or like crops like this, process them, and you can brand it and market it. So that is also another option. So with this, I thank the organizers giving me an opportunity. And you have any questions, please ask. Thank you all.
Thank you, sir. We will go ahead and take some time for questions now. Now I request Professor M.P. Garud and Ms. S.M. Jadhav to ask the questions.
Hello.
Yes.
Sir, is there any successful example of genome editing by using zinc finger nuclease?
Yes.
The question is that?
Yes. Yes, the question is there any successful example of
genome editing
using zinc finger? Yes, it is there. In maize crop, they have done. And it is not so successful. It was done by an Indian scientist only, Vipula Shukla in USA, Doe Agrosciences company. And it was not so successful. It was little successful in maize. And some people tried in cassava, tapioca plant. It was not so successful. But the one reason you can say is it is having non-specific problem, along with its design is also very tedious.
Okay, thank you. Next question is, does the gene knockout mechanism of plant itself affect the genome editing after 3 to 4 generations?
Okay, so if I understood correctly, so when we edit the gene, is it stable? Your question, after 3-4 generation, what happens? Yes. To that, correct? Yes.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, that is, yeah. So here, from the limited studies, what we have seen, just last few slide I showed you, like that camelina, soybean and all. So for 3-4 generation, it is very stable here. But we don't have data for long-term studies. This technology came only in 2013 and results came in 2016.
Okay.
Yeah, and that is the future challenge now. We don't have the data for that.
So the next question is the amount of nutrient is same in genetically modified plants?
The amount of nutrients you are asking, correct?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. So this is the most precise genetic engineering tool, and there will not be any change other than the gene we are targeting. There will not be any other change in theory, I'm telling, but in practice, if you are changing, if you want to edit one plant, one gene, unknowingly, if there is another gene also affected, for example, in another technology, golden rice. In one of the golden rice, what happened? So they wanted to have the vitamin E content, higher vitamin E content, but it also in that golden rice gene got inserted into the auxin gene, the gene producing auxin. Then that is a side effect, yield got reduced. That happened. So therefore, what we have to do is whenever using the next generation sequencing, we have to confirm whatever changes we are doing, that only that is happening, not anything else is happening. Nowadays it is possible to know. We have to check that, and in theory it will not happen.
Okay, thank you. So next question is asked by our one participant Vidya Hinge. How plant virus genes like CP, RP and MP will be exploited to develop resistance against viruses in plants?
Okay, so in very good question. So in plants, we have, as you said, only 6 genes or at the most 10 genes are there. So in case of you said earlier people developed protein based virus resistance. That is, you express coat protein, which is too much coat protein produced in the plant will go and bind the virus particle, virus genome, and virus genome will not be available for infection. That is in case of papaya ring spot virus in Hawaii of USA. So initially they developed coat protein based resistance, but people came to know that that is not really due to the protein, it is due to the coat protein RNA. That is due to the RNAi mechanism. Some of the studies, the resistance due to the coat protein RNA. So among these, we can use all replication associated coat protein, movement protein, and other protein. But replication initiation protein has shown higher efficiency. That is most critical for the plant. So we, okay, another thing I'll tell. So for the virus, we have three options. That is, we can use RNAi. So for virus control, RNA interference and CRISPR based, they or microRNA based, they are almost same, little bit difference is there. In case of CRISPR, we control the DNA level at the, we cut the DNA. In case of RNA, we cut the mRNA here.
Question is asked by Sagar Yadav. Are the regulatory frameworks for CRISPRs are same as our other GMO modified crops?
As far as USA is concerned, the regulations are not same. So United States Department of Agriculture recently told that the regular CRISPR edited crops or mushroom organisms will not be regulated to the in the same level in USA, they said. But in Europe, there are some countries are telling we don't want any in the process also, while obtaining the CRISPR edited crops, we are using the transgenic approach. Even approach is also not acceptable, some European countries are telling. That is why there is so much commercial interest here, Bayer company, Bayer Crop Science, Monsanto and all. So that is the major interest here. In India has given a draft regulations, not finalized yet, in February this year. So India is likely to follow USA things, but we are not sure. When in CRISPR edited crops, there is no foreign DNA at all, isn't it? We are not putting Cry gene into the cotton plant. We are changing the cotton gene only using the that agrobacterium, left border, right border, hygromycin and all, but that we have to remove it. That is called segregation in plant breeding. By segregating that gene construct, we can obtain transgene free plant. So in one word, it is more favorable. People are also don't get scared using this technology.
The next question is asked by Sudhakar Jadhav. Can we change color any seeds like pulses crop through the genome editing, not only the seed coat color but also the whole seed color?
So we can do that if we know the gene color or coat color is controlled by one gene. If we know, the technology doesn't know, it is just works on DNA, it doesn't matter. Only thing is we have to know that gene. If that gene is not known, what we can do is using this technology, keep like out of 100 genes, you shortlist 10 genes. And one by one you edit, then if you get the desired phenotype, then you will discover that gene is responsible for coat color or seed color. Only thing requirement is gene knowledge is required. And one more example I'll give you, like in case of unethical person in China, what he did is CRISPR baby called, what he did is he changed the cell surface protein. One of the cell surface protein he changed, and that protein is required for HIV, you know, CD some receptor on the CD cells, and that babies are resistant to HIV, fine, but that protein is also required for growth. So that they say that CRISPR baby will have early aging, 1 or 2 years less life. That means even after knowing 25 years of research, everybody thought that gene is required only for HIV attachment, but later on it came to know that it has other functionals. So we have to be know perfectly the function.
So the next question is by Yogesh Gaonkar. Is there any effect of climate change during studying genomic and market-based techniques for crop improvements?
I don't think climate change doesn't have any effect on this technology. We do this all technology in the laboratory, has nothing to do with that. But due to the climate change, many diseases which are not there, they are coming. Due to the one of the reason is climate change. For example, the diseases which were transmitted by white fly, which are there in the tropical region, are also coming to the subtropical region, like Himachal Pradesh, Punjab, like this. Climate change has no direct thing associated with CRISPR editing, but using CRISPR editing, we can develop climate smart crops.
Okay. Next question is, along with the PAM site, what kind of important parameters should be considered while designing the gRNA, like promoter site, longer exon region, etc.?
Okay, good question. While designing other than guide RNA, the promoter should be suitable for the expression of this guide RNA. That promoter should be RNA polymerase 3 for transcription, one thing. And exon, viruses don't have exons, whereas plant genes have exons and many exons. We have to target the early exons. If a gene has 8 exons, we have to target the exon number 1. And also we have to take care, exons should be common in all the, that is what you call alternative spliced transcripts. For example, in alternatively spliced transcripts, some exons are missing, but we have to look common exon and target that region. And early is very important.
And the next question.
Another thing here. So we have to remember, if we express too much guide RNA and too much Cas9 protein, what happens? It will be non-specific. Although specificity is dependent on the concentration. This is also another problem in case of application in case of humans. If you give the drug too much, then it will, instead of along with cutting the target, it will cut non-specifically also. Major problem.
Okay. Thank you, sir. The next question is by Dr. Vikas Patade. Whether such crops will be expected from GMO regulations?
Yes, I told you already that. So in USA, they have already exempted. And yes, in India also, we are hopefully, they will be exempted. And another application here is, I will tell you, for example, Monsanto has developed this BT cotton. They have to release one variety, one line or event you call, they have hundreds of other events. So what happened in Agrobacterium has randomly inserted in certain region, like chromosome 5, 6, 7, and chromosomes are very, very long. So there is one effect called position effect variation. So the same cry gene, if it is inserted in certain region, expresses more, other region less, other region medium. So we know what is that region now. Company doesn't tell us, they have kept secret, but any of your foreign gene can be inserted in that region. using the CRISPR-Cas. That means all your transgenic plants earlier developed by luck random, now specifically same transgenic plant can be developed, because we know the site. We have the ability to select site also. Yes, madam. Next question.
So the next question is whether there is any particular database regarding the CRISPR or any GMO group.
Yes, yes. The database is there, like OECD, Organization for Economic Development, OECD, and Economic Cooperation Development in Europe. They are having that one, and another one is USDA. So they have that database. It is maintained, and there are not many examples. I mean, it is very recent technology. And here another thing is, like, for our basic academics purpose, companies are only interested in the genes which are making them, I mean, commercially important. But as a we faculty and students, we are also interested like gene function, like gene function. So that is from academic also, this technology is very good.
The next question is, does this strategy work in case of polyploidy genome crops plants?
Yes, absolutely. It has, yeah, already that camelina plant I told you, it's all hexaploid, and also cotton, wheat, it has worked. Only problem is, remember, limitations are tissue regeneration. And here another thing you remember, what happens, you do manipulations in one variety, for example, cotton variety called Coker 310, you do manipulation in that, then using the traditional breeding, we can cross fertilize to desired variety. It takes long time, but technically possible.
There is announcement for all the participants that all feedback link is provided in the chat box. After feeding the feedback link, you will get an e-certificate in your email address.
Okay. So the next question is, how CRISPR can enhance traditional plant breeding's method for crop improvements?
Okay, so traditional plant breeding method, I just now told you, like if you develop cotton, in cotton, one variety you develop CRISPR edited crop from the cotton. So to transfer it to another one, we need traditional plant breeding here. And CRISPR, if I understand your question, how CRISPR can help plant breeding, or plant breeding helps to CRISPR. So they help one another. For example, in plant breeding, we have many candidate genes, QTL regions. So using this technology, we can say that in the QTL region, means long DNA region, these are the particular genes which help for the trait. And similarly, for plant breeding, we help by cross-fertilization, cross-hybridization with the CRISPR-edited crops, we can transfer it into any variety. And another technology is NGS, next gen sequencing. So that also helps a lot in this process. Yes.
Yes, sir. The next question is by Prashant Shingote. In case of CRISPR developed virus resistant crops, how virus genome is cut without constituting expression of CRISPR system?
Yes, so very good question this is. So if you understood, so in case of CRISPR, for virus resistance, there are two things. One I will tell. One is for RNA viruses, what we do is, we RNA viruses, there is one gene I told you, EIF4G. When we mutate that gene, means that gene will not make a protein, virus will not complete its life cycle. Virus comes, but it will not double, triple, or it will not replicate, because virus replication is inhibited. Okay. Now, in case of DNA virus, there is a problem. In case of DNA viruses, we don't know any plant gene. We are changing the, for example, in DNA viruses, plant will always produce the CRISPR, Cas9 endonuclease and CRISPR RNA. If the virus comes, good. If virus doesn't come, that will be there in the cytoplasma nucleus. So DNA, for DNA resistance, we cannot get a transgene plant in case of DNA viruses.
The next question is by Sandeep Kadam. What is the principal difference in the site-directed mutagenesis and CRISPR editing?
Okay, so in site-directed mutagenesis, what we do is, that is, we do in one gene only. Site-directed mutagenesis, we use mutation in the primary only. Correct? Site-directed mutagenesis, we use mutation in the primer, and using the inverse PCR, we change the gene in our test tube, and then we transform into the plant. That is one thing. And in site-directed mutagenesis, that is the difference. In primer only, we have the mutation there. And earlier, before CRISPR also, there was some recombination-based gene knockout, gene replacement was there. But in plants or higher organisms, recombination doesn't work well. Only in yeast, we can do recombination without any of this CRISPR. Site-directed mutagenesis is different, like it is used in only one gene in case of test tube.
The next question is by Koman Varve. What is the maximum amount of base pairs that can be detected using CRISPR or Cas9 system?
Detected or edited, you mean? Detection, CRISPR-Cas is recently used for diagnostics also, very specifically, that is different thing. So if the question is how long, how big gene we can edit, if the question is that, so using the CRISPR-Cas technology, we can remove the big region of chromosome. For example, 200 base pair chunk of a chromosome can be removed. We have to make two cuts there, and the probability will be less there. If we do all manipulations in the single cell stage, and out of 100 cells, only one cell gets genome edited. 99 cells are wild type. So using this genome, we can remove big chunk of DNA, but replacement is not easy. We can only replace 2 kb, 3 kb. If we want to replace 50 kb gene is not possible because of secondary structure. That DNA will fold in a irregularly and it will not be accessible. Success is very low. And by genome editing, this Cas9, we have seen usually they delete 5, 6, 9, or sometimes 50, 60, but usually you can say 3 to 10 nucleotides. And one nucleotide addition or deletion will create the frameshift mutation. Next.
The last question is, how CRISPR technology can be used to reduce the life cycle or induce early flowering in plants? And please, the base editing also in CRISPR-Cas19.
Base editing is, before that. So there are some genes are there, early flowering. In May, if you want early flowering, what happens? If early flowering happens, the yield will be less. Correct? In some case, for drought situations, we need early flowering to escape the drought problem. But in case of other plants, we need flowering should be depending on the people. We have to manipulate the genes which are responsible for flowering accordingly. It depends on that. And another question is base editing. Very good. So this is base editing technology. It changes one base at a time here. Base editing, we can change we have adenine base editors, cytosine base editors. So CRISPR-Cas, the problem is, you can now realize, CRISPR-Cas we don't have the control. We don't have the control to change only one nucleotide. Correct? We don't have the option to edit, cut only one nucleotide or add only one nucleotide. We can have two, three nucleotides, but base editing, we can do only using one nucleotide at a time. That is the great positive of that thing. And you using even base editing is done using the CRISPR-Cas technology. So that is called dCas, dead Cas, means we use the Cas9 which cannot cut, means Cas9 usually cuts two, makes two cuts, correct? And we use, some people use dead Cas that goes and binds there but doesn't do anything. So to that Cas9 we attach some other protein, for example base editor. Base editor is attached to the Cas9 plus that scaffold RNA, so they are complementary there. So I think you got the point. Using CRISPR-Cas we cannot do one nucleotide change, but base editor we can do.
Sir,
yes,
now I request to Professor R.B. Narvade to give a vote of thanks for this webinar.
On behalf of KKVAC College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Nasik, I extend a really hearty vote of thanks to our resource person, Dr. Basavaraj Bhagewadi, who spared valuable time from his busy schedule to grace the occasion. Today we had an opportunity to hear your thoughts, and this will surely going to encourage us in our future events. Your thoughts have enlightened our minds and have shown us a new path. I am thankful to Honorable Mr. Balasaheb Wagh, Chairman of KKVAC Education Society, Honorable Mr. Samir Wagh, Trustee KKVAC Education Society, Professor K.S. Bandi, Secretary of KKVAC Education Society, who have provided us this platform to arrange such a webinar session. A special mention to our respected coordinator of Saraswati Nagar campus, Dr. V.M. Sevlikar, and Principal of KKVAC Education Society, Principal of KKVAC College of Agricultural Biotechnology, Professor N.S. Paspor, for being the catalyst that stimulated us to do our best and standing as a pillars of strength. I would like to thank the people who work behind the scene to make this event happen, then our technical arrangement team and all the staff members of the college. Last but not least, a big thank you to all the participants who have attended this wonderful webinar session of Dr. Basavaraj Bhagewadi. Thank you. With the permission of Chairman, I announce that this webinar session is over.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
So, yeah.
Narvade.